taken over the pool. We have here our Zoom worship this afternoon at 5 o'clock. All the information can be found on our Facebook page, but otherwise please do contact me and I can send you the details if you'd like to join us. So let us be still as we prepare for worship. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. We now like to listen to our opening hymn, which is Source and Fount of All Creation. through our Saviour Jesus Christ, who sacrificed himself for us to purify a people as his own. Let us confess our sins. Father eternal, giver of light and grace, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in what we have thought, in what we have said and done, through ignorance, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We have wounded your love and marred your image in us. We are sorry and ashamed, and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and lead us out from darkness to walk as children of light. Amen. May the God of all healing and forgiveness draw you to himself and cleanse you from all your sins, that you may behold the glory of his Son, the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand if you are able as we say the Gloria together. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Please be seated. Our special prayer, our collect for the third Sunday of Epiphany. Let us pray. Almighty God, whose Son revealed in signs and miracles the wonder of your saving presence, renew your people with your heavenly grace, and in all our weakness, sustain us by your mighty power, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We now have our readings.
The first reading is 2 Timothy 1, verse 8 to chapter 2, verse 2. So do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, or of me, his prisoner. Rather, join with me in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. He has saved us and called us to be a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time, but is now being revealed through the appearing of our Saviour, Christ Jesus, who was destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. And of this gospel I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher. This is why I am suffering as I am. Yet this is no cause for shame, because I know whom I have believed, and am convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him until that day. What you heard from me, keep as the pattern of sound teaching, with faith and love in Christ Jesus. Guard the good deposit that was entrusted to you. Guard it with the help of the Holy Holy Spirit who lives in us. Examples of disloyalty and loyalty. You know that everyone in the province of Asia has deserted me, including Pygolus and Hermogenes. May the Lord show mercy to the house of Onyporus, because he often refreshed me and was not ashamed of my chains. On the contrary, when he was in Rome, he searched hard for me until he found me. May the Lord grant that he will find mercy from the Lord on that day. You know very well in how many ways he helped me in Ephesus. The appeal renewed. You then, my son, be strong in that grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things you have heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to reliable people who will also be qualified to teach others. This is the word of the Lord. If you're able, please stand. Alleluia, alleluia, we have seen his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage. Alleluia. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew 11, verses 25 to 30. Glory to you, O Lord. The Father revealed in the Son. At that time, Jesus said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned, and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this is what you are pleased to do. All things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
So during these four Sundays of the Epiphany season, we're looking again at the four themes of our pre-Christmas Advent course. So on January 10th, our sermon theme was distance, and last week Ross preached on the theme of what it means to be safe. This week I'll be calling us to ask, who can we trust? What can we trust them with? Why trust them at all? And next week, the final topic in this series will ask the hard question of what it might mean in these days to be normal. Who you can trust and what you can trust them for is the most basic question for all of us. Think back 5 years. 5 years ago, the world saw the start of the campaign that led to the election of Donald Trump as President of the USA. 5 years ago also saw the final stages of the campaign that led to the Brexit referendum vote. Nearly all public commentators identify 2015 and 2016 as the watershed moment when the public value of truth speaking was sidelined, even rejected by some leading political campaigners. 5 years ago, we hardly heard the expressions fake news, fake truth. They've now become part of the mainstream of political discourse. Now we have long been used to politicians stretching what they see as the truth used to people over-promising and under-delivering. And we used to hearing news reports about corrupt dictators in other lands manufacturing their own versions of truth in order to hold on to power. But this is the first time that I can remember when leaders of free Western nations have actually taken pride in developing and proclaiming their own versions of truth in order to achieve their own purposes. Disinformation, a filthy word up to 5 years ago, has become a matter for public pride. The issue of whom you can trust and what you can trust them for has not, for several generations, been as important as it is now. Now, unless we're tempted to think that Christians are above these problems, we only have to consider the tragic undermining of the most basic levels of trust brought about by spiritual and sexual abuse perpetrated by some church members and leaders. Or we could visit the confusion of ideals caused by the intimate relationship between some evangelical Christians and right-wing extremists in some parts of the world. We all know that trust is hugely important at a personal level in our families. Sure, we need to cut each other some slack at times so that we can get on together through all the changing scenes of life in trouble and in joy. But the bedrock value that enables people to live together in families and communities, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, for better, for worse, the bedrock of all this is trust. And the bedrock of trust is love. Our two Bible readings include references to truth in times of stress. Opening our hearts and minds to these will help us to discern what is true and to live with confidence and with peace of heart and mind. So in our first reading, it's easy to see that St. Paul is struggling with the tension between anxiety and stress about the present moment on the one hand, and peace of mind and confidence in the future on the other. Paul has been witnessing to the cross and resurrection of Jesus ever since he was confronted by Christ himself just outside Damascus nearly 30 years ago. He's preached his heart out in city after city. He's seen people respond, sometimes with violence and hostility, but often too with joyful acceptance. Paul has seen Christian communities springing up all over the place, right across the Middle East, as far as Rome, and there's a strong possibility that he even got as far as Spain. If anybody's life's work had been a success, Paul's life's work obviously was. But Paul knows how fragile these Christian communities really are. He knows the struggles and the conflicts and the concerns of the people in them. We see this awareness of how fragile the gospel community was in those early years. It's written on almost every page of the letters that we call the New Testament. And now Paul is an old man. He's in prison. He has every reason to be anxious about whether the gospel witness will be kept up after he has gone. Paul is not, however, in despair. Sure, he's experienced anxiety, but that is because he's actually facing up to the truth about himself and about the gospel community. But coming through the stress and anxiety and putting it firmly into place is a strengthening tone of hopefulness, even confidence. For Paul has not been doing his work alone. There are people whom he can trust to take the work forward. Paul knows that he can trust the Lord, and Paul knows that there are people he can trust with the precious witness to the truth and freedom that the crucified and risen Lord has brought for all people in all places and at all times. So Paul wants to build Timothy up to take the gospel work forward. Just before this morning's passage, Paul gives a tiny glimpse of the way the gospel message has already been guarded and passed on with truth and faithfulness. He speaks of Timothy's Christian grandma and Timothy's Christian mum. And he says to Timothy himself, now it's time for you to stir up the gift of God that came to you through the laying on of my hands. Let God stir you up to new confidence, he says, because we can be sure that God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but a spirit of power and love and of a sound mind. Come on, Timothy, it's time for you to step up to the plate. And Paul is speaking from his own experience. He's learned through the best of times and the worst of times that the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ is to be trusted. Paul says, in effect, I've got no regrets. I couldn't be more sure of my ground. The one I've trusted in to take care of what is trusted to me right to the end. So as Paul is confident that the Lord has trusted him, and as Paul is confident in trusting Christ, Paul entrusts the message to Timothy. And at the end of our reading, Paul says to Timothy, what you've heard from me through many witnesses, you entrust to other faithful people who'll be able to teach others as well. The truth of the good news of God in Jesus is passed on through faithful witnesses remaining trustworthy with the truth and passing it forward in their own times and across the generations. The reason that we're worshipping here today, the reason we're worshipping together in our homes, is that the people Paul and his followers trusted with the truth proved trustworthy right down to our own times. Now, when we turn to this morning's gospel, you might think I'm being irreverent, even blasphemous, when I say that this morning's gospel reading from Matthew shows Jesus speaking about gentleness and trust at a time when he himself has been experiencing terrible disappointment and stress. You might not think of Jesus getting stressed, but he did. As Matthew has organized his telling of the story of Jesus, the passage straight before this morning's gospel reading has Jesus speaking about God's judgment on places where he himself has preached his heart out, brought miracles of healing, and brought the very touch of the loving God to people broken by their suffering and hunger. Jesus' language seems extreme. He says, even the pagan towns of Tyre and Sidon will be better off at the final judgment than Capernaum, where Jesus healed the paralytic and Peter's mother-in-law and many others, and Bethsaida, the place where Jesus fed the 5,000. This is terrible stuff. So where can Jesus look to find people he can trust with the truth of his message? Suddenly, as Matthew presents the story of Jesus, the atmosphere changes completely as daylight dawning after the darkness of night. Jesus is praying in such a way that the disciples close to him can hear what he's saying. I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you've hidden these things from the wise and intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Where might Jesus look for people who can be trusted to welcome and pass on the truth of his message? He'll look among children, people like children. We know that Jesus loved children. Mark tells us the story of how he took children in his arms and blessed them when the disciples wanted them to be pushed out of the way. But why can the Father not trust the wise and intelligent? Probably because they tend to overthink the gospel such that their learning and sophistication can get in the way of the simplicity and directness of the good news of God's love for the poorest and most vulnerable. It's not that intelligence and wisdom are no use to God. The point is that the sophistication of intelligence and wisdom are no substitute for the direct encounter with the love of God in Jesus. Jesus says, in effect, that the kind of relationship with the Father he wants people to have has the same qualities the qualities of love and trust, of truthfulness and grace, the same qualities as his own relationship with the Father. This is about openness, it's about directness, it's about simplicity. Jesus seems to change in a split second from prayer to his Father to speaking tenderly to the people around him. He knows that many of them are stressed and burdened, many of them up to their necks in debt, struggling to get by from day to day. He knows that they are constantly faced with the questions of who they can rely on not to let them down, who they can trust. So Jesus says to them, "Come to me, all you who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Come and let me walk with you and share the load. Learn from my way of handling all this, for I'm gentle and humble in heart, and you'll find rest. Walking with me, trusting me to be with you, will lead to your finding the burden is still there, but it's a whole lot lighter because we're sharing the load together." Who can you trust to be truthful about how things are, the challenges that face us, the relationships we need between peoples and nations, the relationships of quality we need in our own families and in our own hearts? These are some of the most pressing questions of our generation, and certainly one of the most pressing questions for all people of faith and for Christian people today. Who can you trust? The truth we can trust is not to be found in the phony self-seeking power claims of so many public figures, but in the gentle, compassionate, calm, caring love of God that puts the most vulnerable people, children, people bearing heavy burdens, first. We're called day by day to make decisions about who we can trust, what we can trust them with, and why we should trust them at all. For us to grow deep in trust, we need to grow deep in love, deep in truth, deep in grace, deep in the knowledge and love of God in Jesus. Then we will be strengthened to have confidence like Paul, to live well in the presence, and to be released to entrust to others what needs to be taken forward into God's future for our families, and for our faith, and for our world. Amen.
If you are able, please stand as we affirm our faith together in the words of the Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. He became incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated for our time of prayer.
Responses in you we trust. O God our Father, Paul exhorts us to take what he has spoken to Timothy as the pattern of sound teaching, with faith and love in Christ, to guard what has been entrusted into our keeping. Help us, Lord, to guard it now, and with the help of the Holy Spirit, please hear our prayer. We thank you for the gift of trust. It is part of our everyday life and the very core of our faith. We give thanks that you said you would never forsake or abandon us. And we take comfort in times of trial that we can put our trust in you. We give thanks for all areas of life where trust is paramount. We trust the bus driver will get us to our destination, the pilot flying us to Barbados, the doctor when he gives us advice. We see the innocent trust of children in those who are responsible for them. And in our relationship with you, trust is a great part of that relationship. We thank you that when you told us to trust in you, that you would take care of our anxieties and burdens upon yourself, that we may feel lighter and free from fear. What a saviour. Christ our Redeemer, in you we trust. We pray, dear Lord, for our church, for all its leaders, for all who minister, lay or ordained. We pray that you will inspire, uphold, and sustain their ministries. We ask you to be in the midst of our praise and worship as it takes on a different presentation to that which we have known. We thank you for technology that allows us to still reach a wider congregation than ever before. May the seed sown be of the Holy Spirit, Lord. Christ our Redeemer, in you we trust. We pray for your world, for the natural world. We trust that we can undo the bad and make fresh beginnings, to be able to repair mistakes we have made, that our planet may recover and flourish. Bring about a change of attitudes, and that we will be good stewards of all that you have put in our domain, bringing unity and restoration to all that is damaged. May it not be too late. Christ our Redeemer, in you we trust. We pray for the decision makers, especially for all those in authority, to be given the wisdom of Solomon as we endeavour to tame and subdue this virus. We pray for those countries where they are trying their best to beat COVID, but with so little resources. May provision be made to help them. We pray for Joe Biden and his government. Give him a vision of how to bring about unity and a ceasing of violence in America. We pray for all key workers and their families, for their safety and protection, for those involved in the vaccination programme, those administering the jabs, for all who are volunteers as marshals and guides. Give all in our community hearts of obedience and blessed thoughtfulness towards each other. Have mercy on us, gracious Lord. May we see a swift recovery soon. Christ, our Redeemer, in you we trust. Lastly, we pray for ourselves, for all those whom we love and pray for. We ask for healing for the sick, Alan, Peter, Harriet, Jennifer, Imogen. May they each be restored and healed. We pray for all those mourning the loss of loved ones. We pray especially for Anne Keeley and Jill Betts and their families. May they know your peace and comfort in their hearts. May our feet be guided in the need to be obedient and trustworthy. May you cause your face to shine upon us, Lord. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
If you are able, please stand for the peace. Christ is our peace. If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, everything has become new. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let's share with one another a sign of peace with a wave or a bow of a kiss. Please be seated as we listen to our second hymn, and those of you at home can sing your hearts out to King of Kings, Majesty.
Thank you.
Lord, accept your people's gifts, not gold, frankincense, or myrrh, but hearts and voices raised in praise of Jesus Christ, our light and our salvation.
Amen.
Amen. The Lord is here.
God's Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
All honour and praise be yours, always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever-living God, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. For at this time we celebrate your glory made present in our midst, in the coming of the Magi, the King of all the world was revealed to the nations. In the waters of baptism, Jesus was revealed as the Christ, the Saviour sent to redeem us. In the water made wine, the new creation was revealed at the wedding feast. Poverty was turned to riches, sorrow into joy. Therefore, with all the angels of heaven, we lift our voices to proclaim the glory of your name and sing our joyful hymn of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord, as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper had ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence, his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, bringing before you the bread of life and the cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with all the saints to the feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, forever and ever. Amen. Rejoicing in the presence of God here among us, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. The body of Christ broken for you. Almighty Father, whose Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, is the light of the world, may your people, illumined by your word and sacraments, shine with the radiance of his glory, that he may be known, worshipped and obeyed to the ends of the earth. For he is alive and reigns, now and forever. Amen. And we pray together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Christ our Lord, to whom kings bow down in worship and offered gifts, reveal to you his glory and pour upon you the riches of his grace, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you, be with those you love and pray for this day and always. Amen. We now listen to, and those of you at home can sing along to, Forth in the Peace of Christ We Go.
Thank you.
prayer for Christian unity, and in that last verse, we are his church, he makes us one. Here is one hearth for all to find. Here is one flock, one shepherd king. Here is one faith, one heart, one mind. Let us be praying for our brothers and sisters in Christ across our world, for unity and for love, in one faith, in one heart, in one love of Christ. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.